Good morning, church. Are you guys ready to praise his name this morning? Is he good? I can't hear you guys. Amen. Children of freedom, every race and every nation, sing it out, sing a new hallelujah, yeah. Let us sing love to the nation, bring a hope of the grace that is free.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, we've come into this place to praise you, to praise Yahweh. Hallelujah. Because you've made us alive in Jesus Christ. Be with us in this hour, Lord, and we sense your presence even now. Help us, Lord, to worship you as you seek worshipers, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Indeed, as we hear truth today, Lord, may you give us hearts to respond to it, to embrace it, and embrace it in such a way that the desire of our heart is to live it out day by day. I pray, Lord, that you meet all of us where we are. We've experienced various different things this last week and things maybe we need to face this week that are troubling and challenging. But we remember the words of Paul who said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And so strengthen us in this hour. Anoint us to worship. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear that we might be changed and equipped, Lord, to serve you both in your church and in the world, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, happy Mother's Day. For whom that applies. It's good to see you. I'm not a mother, but I'm a father. I guess we'll get to that, won't we, in a few weeks. But it was an extraordinary thing the day that Victoria was born. It was an ontological change. We went from being a couple to being a family. And from being husband and wife to being mother and father. And it was an extraordinary thing. And I think maybe in some sense I came to understand God just a little bit more, beginning on that day, because God is our Father. Amen? Amen. Well, anyway, not only is it Mother's Day, it's the sixth Sunday in Easter, so we're glad that you're here. The sound system is glad that you're here as well, and we hope that you're doing well. Just as a reminder, this week's bulletin can be found if you scan the QR code in the seat ahead of you. And there you'll find today's scripture lessons, giving options, and spiritual growth opportunities as they're coming up. And also, if you happen to be a guest with us today, or if you're relatively new to Holy Cross, we hope that you'll go on the online bulletin and click on the tab that's labeled Newcomer and Guest, because we'd like to get to know you. Also, just a reminder, youth and children will be leaving the worship space to go to the education wing at the passing of the peace for age-specific programming. Youth will be meeting with Alan and his assistants at the double doors pulpit side in the back, and children will be meeting with their teacher and helpers at the double doors on the band side. And just a reminder about communion, if you've been baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we want to welcome you to come with the rest when we take communion. And if you haven't been so baptized, if you'd like to come with the rest, and when you get to the front, if you just make the sign of the cross like this across your chest, we'll give you a blessing, because we want everyone to participate in that part of the service who wants to participate. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
draws near and my time has come. And still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and oh my soul, and worship His holy name. Sing like never.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated.
A reading from Isaiah. Behold my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. I will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry aloud or lift up his voice or make it heard in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a faintly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth and the coastlands wait for his law. The word of the Lord.
For this day is Psalm 2. Why are the nations in an uproar? Why do the peoples mutter empty threats? Why do the kings of the earth rise up in revolt and princes plot together against the Lord and against his anointed? Let us break their yoke, they say. Let us cast off their bonds from us. He whose throne is in heaven is laughing. The Lord has them in derision. And then he speaks to them in his wrath, and his rage fills them with terror. I myself have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. Let me announce the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son, this day have I begotten you. Ask of me and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall crush them with a rod of iron and shatter them like a piece of pottery. And now you kings be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Submit to the Lord with fear and with trembling bow before him, lest he be angry and you perish, for his wrath is kindled quickly. Happy are they all who take refuge in him.
A reading from Thessalonians. Finally, then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you received from us how you ought to walk and to please God, just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor, not in passion of lust, like the Gentiles who do not know God. That no one transgress and wrong his brother in this matter, because the Lord is an avenger in all these things, as we told you beforehand and solemnly warned you. For God has not called us for impurity, but in holiness. Therefore, whoever disregards this, disregards not man, but God, who gives his Holy Spirit to you. Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. For that indeed is what you are doing to all the brothers throughout Macedonia. But we urge you, brothers, to do this more and more. The word of the Lord.
This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. And Jesus told the people a parable. Can a blind person guide a blind person? Will not both fall into a pit? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is fully qualified will be like the teacher. And why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but you don't notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your neighbor, friend, let me take out the speck in your eye, when you yourself do not see the log in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. No good tree bears bad fruit. Nor again does a bad tree bear good fruit. For every tree is known by its own fruit. Figs are not gathered from thorns, nor are grapes picked from a bramble bush. The good person out of the good treasure of the heart produces good, and the evil person out of an evil treasure produces evil. For it is out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. And why do you call me Lord and do not do what I tell you? The gospel of the Lord. And so, Heavenly Father, as we come to your word, we pray that we would hear not just the words of men, but the words of God. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. And so today we are wrapping up our four-part series that we call the Simple Series. In this series, we've been describing and explaining in some detail that model of ministry that we're presently pursuing here at Holy Cross, a model of ministry designed to help us be more authentic disciples of Jesus Christ and to help others be more authentic disciples of Jesus Christ, indeed being disciples of Jesus Christ and helping others to be disciples and to do the same is the church's primary mission. In fact, we read famously in Matthew's gospel, Jesus before his ascension and after his resurrection. But Matthew begins in chapter 28 and in verse 18, and Jesus came and he said to his disciples, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And so, I have the authority. Listen to me. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And so since this is what Jesus wants us to be doing, he wants us to be disciples, he wants us to be helping others to be disciples, at Holy Cross we're trying to make this simple purpose the primary thing of everything that we do. And the process for accomplishing this simple purpose is as simple as the purpose itself. Indeed, in order to be disciples of Jesus Christ ourselves and to help others be disciples, we are committing ourselves and inviting others to the pursuit of four simple steps. Now, to get a handle on this process, we've created a simple visual. And the first step is worship God regularly. The second step, as we talked about it a few weeks back, is grow together faithfully. Worship God regularly. Grow together faithfully. Last week we talked about serving others lovingly. And the fourth step is mature in Christ continuously. And today that's what we're talking about, this fourth and last step. Mature in Christ continuously. Indeed, the ultimate goal of the Christian life is not just getting stuff from God or admiring Jesus from afar. Rather, the goal of the Christian life is becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. Indeed, the goal of the Christian life is growth in spiritual maturity. And this goal of growth and spiritual transformation, this becoming more and more like Jesus Christ, is not so much a destination at which we arrive, at least not in this life, but rather an ongoing spiritual journey, if you will, from one level of spiritual maturity to another. Indeed, maturity in Christ is not so much a goal that we finally achieve as it is an exciting and life-changing transformation process that never ends. Indeed, I heard Chuck Swindoll put it this way once: the plan of the Christian life is not spiritual perfection, but spiritual progress. The plan of the Christian life is not spiritual perfection, but spiritual progress. Or as someone else famously said, God loves you just the way you are, but he loves you too much just to leave you there. And so maturing in Christ is a dynamic, ongoing process. And because it's a process, change and growth are essential to it. Indeed, if you're not changing and growing and maturing spiritually, that's because you aren't engaged in the process. Sometimes people talk about, being on a journey. But too often this kind of language is used as some sort of a left-handed explanation for why the quality of the Christian life isn't quite what they know it should be. Well, you know I'm on a journey. But if as Christians we're growing and maturing the way we ought to be growing and maturing as time goes by, if we aren't spiritually adulting, to use contemporary language, that's because we're not on a journey and we're not engaging the process. Indeed, if week after week and month after month and year after year, as is sometimes the case, we aren't growing and maturing in our faith and practice, that's not because we're on a spiritual journey. That's because, in fact, we are not on a spiritual journey. Indeed, if we're not growing and changing and maturing spiritually and becoming more and more like Christ, that's because we've gotten off the road that leads to spiritual transformation and change and have instead set up camp somewhere along the side of the road. And because of this, the maturing process within us has been short-circuited. And that was the problem, by the way, with the believers at Corinth. If you are familiar with Paul's letters to the Corinthians, the quality of their common life had stagnated, and they weren't growing. In fact, we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, rather difficult words to read, perhaps, But Paul says to them, brothers and sisters, I couldn't address you as spiritual people when I was with you. That is, people who were growing and maturing in the things of the Spirit. I couldn't talk to you like people like that. Rather, I had to talk to you as people of the flesh, people of who are driven by the fallen human nature, as infants, he says, that is, as babies, as those who were spiritually immature, as infants in Christ. He said, I fed you milk as like from a bottle. That is the basics. And I couldn't give you solid food, which is a reference to teaching beyond the basics, for you weren't ready for it, he said. And even now you're not ready, even though they should have been ready. Lots of time had passed. In fact, if you read the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul spent lots of time in Corinth, 2.5 years founding the church there. He continues on. He says, for you are still of the flesh. He says, for while there's jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? That is, behaving just like people who don't even make a claim to follow Christ. And sometimes in the church, that's just how people act. The same problem existed amongst the believers to whom the writer to the Hebrews is writing. In Hebrews chapter 5 and beginning at verse 11, we read his words. He says to this group, he says, and about this, he's a particular subject that he was talking about. And about this particular subject, I have much to say, but it's hard to explain since you've become dull of hearing. The spiritual dullness. For though by this time you ought to be teachers of these things, to know them well enough and understand them that you can share them with others. But you need someone again to teach you the basic principles of the Word of God. I have to take you back to the ABCs. You need milk, baby food, and not solid food. Indeed, these believers weren't growing, they weren't maturing, but instead they were suffering from a sort of spiritual retardation. Adequate time had passed, allowing for growth and change and maturity. Unfortunately, they weren't growing, and they hadn't grown. And unfortunately, sometimes this is still a problem in the church today. In fact, I remember a few years back, at the end of one of the belonging courses, and we had a, what would you call it, a survey at the end. And one of the questions was, well, how would you describe yourself at the beginning of the course? And this person who was advanced in age and had been in the church all of his life wrote, at the beginning of the course, I would describe myself as a novice. And then at the end it says, and how would you describe yourself now that you've taken the course? And he said, as a novice. And all his life in the church, something broke down somewhere. And yet maturity in Christ is the goal of the Christian life. As someone has written, there's no reward for admiring Jesus. Jesus isn't looking for admirers. Rather, the writer continues, Jesus is looking for followers, for disciples who are actively learning from him how to live their lives as he lived his. Indeed, the goal of the Christian life isn't just about believing certain things, although what we believe is important. And the goal of the Christian life isn't just about doing certain things and not doing other things, which of course is important too. Rather, the goal of the Christian life is to be constantly becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. Indeed, this is the sine qua non, to use a Latin tag, without which nothing. The sine qua non of authentic discipleship, Christ-likeness. And this is the difference between authentic discipleship and cultural Christianity. Indeed, Jesus doesn't just mean to be our Savior so he can forgive us of our sins, or to be our deliverer and give us peace of mind when we find our mind troubled and things get tough. In addition to all of this, Jesus means to be our model and our Lord. In fact, the last thing that Jesus asks in that passage that we read from Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, he asks the rhetorical question, why do you call me Lord and you don't do what I say? It's a very challenging question. Indeed, as we've already said, the goal of the Christian life isn't just about getting stuff from Jesus. The goal of the Christian life is being like Jesus more and more, day by day, step by step, because we're on a journey. Even if those steps are baby steps. But you can't even take baby steps when you're sitting down and you've set up camp somewhere. Indeed, you're not on a journey if you're sitting down. And you're not on a journey if you're not going anywhere. I always appreciated something a former professor of mine said, Norman Geisler. He used to say that even God can't direct a parked car. He was a philosopher, by the way. Even God can't direct a parked car. Indeed, in order to be getting somewhere, you have to be moving. And you can't get to your final destination while parked motionless on the side of the road. And the intended destination of the Christian life is maturity in Christ. Paul talked about this in his letter to the Ephesians, in Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at verse 11. Where he wrote, and Christ gave to the church as gifts. He gave apostles. And he gave prophets, evangelists. He gave shepherds, or that is pastors and teachers. Why? To equip the saints, to equip believers in Christ for the work of ministry, for the doing of the one another's. Love one another, teach one another, encourage one another, challenge one another, love one another. For the building up of the body of Christ, not tearing it down, building it up. Until we all attain to the unity of faith, knowing what we believe, and the knowledge of the Son of God. Not just knowledge about, but experientially. I know him. You know him. To mature manhood, or adulthood, we would say. To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. We mentioned this last week. Well, you know, I'm not Jesus Christ. You're called to be. I'm called to be. That's not an excuse. If you're failing, repent. And God, as the scriptures say, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. And then move on to maturity. To mature manhood or adulthood, to the measure of this stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by every wave and carried about by every wind of teaching, by human cunning and by the craftiness and deceitfulness of people who would deceive us. Rather, he says, speaking the truth in love to one another, we're growing up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. Or if you like to be maturing in Christ continuously. It's always intrigued me how some Christians seem to shy away from seriously committing themselves to this process that leads to maturity in Christ. Concerned seemingly that if they were to really throw themselves into it, it'll somehow lead to something they don't like. But truth be told, being spiritually mature is a lot more satisfying than being spiritually immature. In fact, you might do a little study, a little research, and see if that's not true. I found it to be true. People who are spiritually mature and are growing, they seem a great deal happier than those who aren't. It's as satisfying as much more satisfying being adult than it is being a baby. Babies are crying all the time. Have you noticed that? Indeed, those who are actively maturing in Christ more often than not are those who are faithful and growing in faith, those who are courageous and growing in courage, who are gracious and growing in grace, who are generous and growing in generosity, who are free and growing in freedom, who are joyful and growing in joy, who are peaceful and growing in peace, who are thankful and growing in gratitude and empowered by it, who are wise and growing in wisdom. And so what's not to like about any of that? Indeed, if developing such things like that in your own life sounds good, I want to encourage you to work the process. Step one, worship God regularly. Make worship a priority in your life. It was a priority in Jesus, just as we read in the New Testament, and he went to the synagogue as was his custom. He was customarily there. If you went, he'd be there. Step two, grow together faithfully. Take every opportunity that's presented you to learn and to grow together in your faith, together with other believers in small settings. Step three is serve others lovingly. Because serving others in love is the distinguishing mark of an authentic disciple of Jesus Christ and mature in Christ continuously. Commit yourself to becoming more and more like Jesus Christ in your private life, in your home life, in your church life, in your business life, so that who we see is really you. And what we see, hopefully more often than not, is what Christ would look like if we saw him ourselves. Be a student of Christ, because you can't do what Jesus would do if you don't know what Jesus did. Be a disciple. Learn what he did. Imitate what he did. And never stop. And watch things change. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, what would the church be like if we were all chasing after you? What kind of church are we? Are we like the Corinthians? Or are we like the Philippians, who were generous and persevering and joyful? Or the Thessalonians? All kinds of churches. Some that are chasing after you, and some maybe that aren't chasing after you very hard. Lord, I pray that we would be a church that's chasing after you hard, not only because it's the right thing to do, but it's the good thing to do. It's the thing that will benefit us most. There's nothing to be lost and everything to gain. You are the light, and when we walk away, we walk into darkness. You are the life, and when we walk to you, we walk into life. When we walk away, we walk into death. There is nothing to be lost and everything to gain. Help us to do it, we pray, and start with me. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand together and proclaim our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, silently or aloud.
And Heavenly Father, we continue in our prayers for our brothers and sisters around the world who are being persecuted because of their faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. And we pray, Lord, for those who persecute them. And for our brothers and sisters here at the church and their various needs, we're praying, and those for whom they've asked us to pray. We're praying, Lord, for Elaine, for Christopher and Anne, for Johnny, Jacob, Jesse, Zeke, and Rachel, for Carolyn, for Carlene, Larry, and Jason, for Andrew, David, Christy, Abby, and Grace, for Bob and Mimi, for Olivia, for Marvin, for Lois, Lance, and Kara, for Ludmilla, for Bill and Doris, for Jane, and for Anne, for Lance, and for Kristen. We pray, Lord, for Connie, for Patty, for Bubba, for Brad, and for Michael. Almighty God, from whom comes every good and perfect gift, we thank you on this special day for the gift and blessing of godly mothers. May their reward be great in heaven, who in our youth pointed us to the path that leads to eternal life. And may we forever honor them who, by word and deed, demonstrated for us the true value of godly living. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we've left undone. We've not loved you with our whole heart. We've not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Please be seated. Just a couple of things we want to remind you about. Today begins the Baby Bottle Boomerang Project. As we've been saying, it starts today on Mother's Day. And this is a fun and loving way to support the ministry of the Pregnancy Resource Center here in Fort Bend County, both by your prayers and your monetary gifts. Indeed, this is how it's going to work. After service, empty baby bottles will be distributed to anyone who wants one. And then from today to Father's Day, we want to encourage you to put loose change or loose bills or perhaps write a check to the Pregnancy Resource Center and put it in the empty bottle. And then when you come to church on Father's Day, bring that bottle along and we'll collect those. And then we will make sure that the Pregnancy Resource Center here in Fort Bend County gets them. If you want more information about that, you can see the electronic bulletin. Also, the belonging course, our spring belonging course in 2023, will start next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. We've got a great group that's shaping up. The belonging course is something that we've had at Holy Cross for quite some time. Different people take the course for different reasons. Some are new to Holy Cross and they want to learn a little bit more about what Holy Cross is about. Others maybe have been at Holy Cross for a while, but they want to learn a little bit more about the distinctives of the Episcopal Anglican tradition. Others take it because it's a prerequisite for confirmation when the bishop comes. But whatever the reasons, it's always a good time. It's one of my favorite things to do, maybe because people like it so much. As I was saying to somebody on the phone the other day, we get to the end of the course and they say, "Is that it?" So it's a good thing. Anyway, we want to invite you to come to the first session, which is what we usually do. The first session will be next Sunday, the 21st of May. And you can sign up and register online. If you go to the electronic bulletin, you'll see the belonging course there, and there's a link for you to register for that first session. Or you also can sign up for it in the gathering space. There's a sign up just as you're on your way to the education wing where the washrooms are. As you pass by that black covered table covered with a black cloth, you'll see a sign up there. The belonging course is in three parts. One is belonging to the family of God. The second part is belonging to the Anglican Communion. And the third part is belonging to Holy Cross Church. So anyway, child care is provided. And if you need that, just indicate that and we'll be sure that you have that. As we mentioned last week, the Holy Cross Youth is having their retreat on the last weekend in June. And the first weekend in July, because that's just the way the dates fall. It's $100 per student. Space is limited, but if you have more than one student going, there's special pricing and there's also scholarships available. And if you'd like to know more about that, you can see the electronic bulletin and click on Youth Retreat. Also, the VBS, Stellar VBS, is coming up in July, the week of the 10th through the 14th. Registration is now open for children who will have graduated from kindergarten and through to the fifth grade. And we also are looking for crew leaders and other helpers who can register to assist with that ministry. And if you're interested in that, you can click on Stellar VBS in the electronic bulletin. Just one last thing, and that is just an update about communications. In an attempt to communicate with you without having to send multiple emails and texts during the week, we've started sending a weekly electronic newsletter that contains all the ministry updates and things that are happening at Holy Cross. It gets sent out on Thursdays, every Thursday at 3 o'clock. And if we have your contact information in the Breeze account, we are sending that to you. If we don't have your information in Breeze, you can also go to the electronic bulletin and you can provide that information. One of the things that Eric, who's our office manager, is suggesting is that you put in your email contact list office OFFICE, office at holycrosschurch.com. And we're trying to keep this stuff out of the junk. And we're thinking that perhaps if, and in fact, he may very well know that if you have that in your contacts list, then your computer won't throw it into the junk. However, if you get to Friday and you don't see the newsletter, check the your junk file, because we want to make sure that we're communicating with you. Also, just one last thing, and that is that we'll be posting updated info on what's happening at Holy Cross on both Facebook and Instagram. And so if you aren't following Holy Cross on those platforms, we invite you to do so. And to access the links to Facebook and Instagram, you can click on the blue tab in the electronic bulletin, and that's labeled Follow Us on Facebook and Instagram, and you should be all set up. Remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that he said it, it's more blessed to give than to receive.
Take all this out.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly we're bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. And therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." And therefore we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia, Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. body of Christ.
Your glory, God, is what I
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. And so go in peace, and in the power of the Holy Spirit, let each one of us seek to be a benefit and a blessing to everyone we meet, as we seek also to be ever growing in love in our relationship with God, in our relationship with one another, and in our relationship with the world around us. Alleluia. Alleluia. You are dismissed.
And speak your peace, and speak your peace, and speak your peace.